verse 16 in just a moment. The Dentons, we need to remember them. We got some folks. If y'all don't mind, if I forget somebody, speak up. We had a group text before church. Rachel Denton has COVID. Ellie maybe has it, symptomatic. Jason and them are not here, obviously, for that. I want to remember them. Somebody else, too.
Nancy Stansberry.
Stansberry.
She's going on hospice.
Yeah, that's Mary Ann's sister-in-law. Mary's sister. Yeah, I think what Donnie said was she's just not going to take any more treatment. So remember Mary Ann's sister. And
I had to put Cindy Comer back on the band.
Yeah, they really. Cindy Comer's back on the band.
She has pneumonia now. She's developed it.
Yeah, she's gone.
And Brian Scott, which is Kenny Scott's little brother,
Brian,
has COVID and pneumonia.
You sent a text that earlier in the week, didn't you? There's so many now. I'm starting to lose track of the text thing.
No, Lynn Jordan,
yeah,
is being transferred to Centennial. He has an infection in his heart and brain.
It's MRSA, isn't it? Isn't that what they said?
Shelly just posted it like 4 minutes ago on the Facebook page.
What Barbara told me just a little while ago was that they found the infection that was causing most of his problem, and it was in his heart and in his brain cavity, and they were moving him to Centennial because they didn't have the doctors that they needed there. So
really?
This was just right after knee surgery.
Yeah.
And he had the knee surgery like Monday.
That sounds very serious as well.
Who was it?
Lynn Jordan.
Lynn Jordan.
Yeah. Scotty worship here for his.
That's my niece.
Yeah.
Husband, Barbara and Alton Driver, their son-in-law.
Casey is going to have some more procedures. She's.
I didn't want to mention that. I don't know if that was. Carol.
Just neurological. And you know how medicine is, they're trying to rule out all things, the most serious things first. So we'll wait and see.
Todd, too, has been sick. He's got some problems. Neurological, I suppose, would be the best, I guess, way to describe that.
What we got was he was having lost the blood flow to the brain, and they were trying to figure out why he was having a restriction in the blood flow.
And Robert, blood clots in his legs. He's had those before, thank you. So, anyway, they remember that family. Y'all remember Mom and Dad, too? Dad's been real sick. Mom finally took him to the hospital Monday, and they did a COVID test, and at the time, either when they call them back the next day, they don't have it. Of course, then they made them feel better by saying, but you could have it, and this may not, of course. Anyway, and then had some x-rays done, thought he had pneumonia, probably doesn't have pneumonia, but he's been pretty sick at home. So he's hard to get to go to the doctor. But 92 years old, just don't like being told what to do. You're 92 years old, and you got the right to just say, nah. But you really need to.
He's made quite a recovery because it wasn't very long ago. He was in the nursing home or whatever.
Yeah, he's had,
I didn't know if he was going to get out.
We didn't think so either. So, he gets down, he gets back up again. He's just, he's had three heart surgeries, prostate cancer, knees replaced. Yep, I told him. I said, Dad, they'll date you up years from now, and I think a robot was buried there. So, got all these artificial parts, like buried a cyborg. Anyway, but do remember them. And again, they're in the house. Mama's been getting out way too much. We didn't find this out Anybody else? I do have some news, and we need to put this in bulletin. I talked to Mark and Christine Wright. Sunday took her over for a ride, and I never really felt like they left, but they want to place membership here. You know, they were gone for a while for different circumstances. But anyway, they want it to be known that they want to place membership here on the oversight of the elders, so we'll put that in the bulletin, probably need to announce that. So they were asking me, you know, it's funny, you know, what do we need to do? Well, we just tell some folks and stuff, really. You don't have to come forward or fall down on the altar or something. Anyway, we're glad to have them. So that's some good news.
I did talk to Colin Williams this week, and she is improving. She's starting therapy on her knee at the end of this week. And she had knee surgery like 6 weeks ago, and she just now able to start therapy on it.
Okay.
Talked to Pat Foster. Pat Foster is, she went to see her doctor Monday, and she's on drug recovery. What they did, the nerve that they did, what he's doing, will do it for her. And that Mitchell is doing very well. The scan that she got last week showed that the tumor has shrunk.
Okay.
Yeah, but they're going to keep going with the chemo. They say it's going to be an ongoing thing the rest of her life.
Right.
So that's something she's got to deal with forever. One of the lines is at home. She's feeling okay, but she is improving a little bit also.
What about Mr. Hiram? I hadn't heard he was doing good or better. That was like a month ago.
Jason went over there, I guess it was Friday, and he was standing up, stood up for 45 minutes.
Really?
So they let him put weight on his leg. He's still having to use a walker, but he started this week doing therapy on the ramp that we made. They're using that for physical therapy.
Oh, good. Dual purpose. That's good.
How's Dallas doing?
Dallas and Lillian. Dallas is doing well. Lillian, I think, is still on oxygen.
She is.
She's off the ground, she told me.
Yeah. It's not like a continuous thing anymore, but yes, Cindy, and also Cindy talked to Terry Burton before we came, and they still need prayers. They're still pretty sick. I thought they were.
They were just like around the roller coaster.
Yeah, he said they feel like maybe they turned the corner and then it just knocks them back down again. So both of them, Renee and Terry. So anyway, because theirs has been going pretty well too. Anybody else?
We have 18 teachers at Myers County that are infected.
I heard
and
that.
School's closed on November 3rd.
Yeah. That, well, I saw that was, Donnie sent that out in that group text message, didn't he? Yeah. This county, and staying in particular, is pretty bad. It's actually worse than it was back in March, so be careful.
Your friendships start to get in town. Some of Maddie and Eli's classmates are quarantined.
Oh, a new one? I heard a couple of weeks ago, so this has been.
Last week, I think we found out.
Oh, yeah.
In Maddie's class.
What grade is Maddie in?
Seven.
Seven.
Eight.
Eight.
Thanks,
Coach.
Dustin Justice.
Who's that man?
It's Linda Rollins' grandson-in-law.
Oh, yeah, he's got cancer, yeah.
He's a cancer patient.
Yeah.
He was in remission for that.
You know, Linda Rollins for a long time, long time. Anybody else? Well, tell about when, dear my father, we approach your throne so often, and before we even thank you for all the blessings you give us, we ask for things. Forgive us, dear Lord, when we act selfish, when we forget all of the blessings and every good and perfect gift that you shower down on us every day. Sometimes we don't appreciate our health or the health of our loved ones until it's suffering or in serious peril. We pray, dear Lord, for those that have been mentioned here tonight, those that we love and care for, our number, of your the branch of your body here, that are so sick, have loved ones that are sick, that are struggling. Pray for them, dear Lord. We pray for them. We pray for their healing. We pray for their restoration of not only their health, but their position back in their families as soon as possible. Dear Lord, we know that this life is short. Help us to remember that as well when we pray and when we live our lives. But this life, we're just passing through. Help us, dear Lord, to lay up treasure in heaven where there is no more disease and suffering and illness, no financial hardships and no physical or emotional stress, the things that we struggle with here so much. We're thankful, dear Lord, for Jesus, who lived as one of us, who knows the things that we say now, has experienced them like we have. We're thankful for that perfect sacrifice for us. We know that because of that, because of the efforts that he made for us while he walked on this earth, lived as one of us, that we can have hope that our prayer will be answered according to your will. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. All right. Time will spend. Time will spend. Let's open up to John chapter 19. I mean, John chapter 20. Back it up there. And then we'll try to pick up where we left off last week. This is Peter and John have run to the tomb. Mary has run to the tomb. Jesus calls her by name and mentions in verse 15, you know, a woman who are you looking for. In verse 16, calls her by name. I don't want to skip over that. I kind of did last week. Names are important. We brought forth a lot of people's names tonight. It's how many of y'all like me? And I used to be pretty good at it, but as I get older, it's tough. How many of you have trouble remembering names now?
Names is the worst thing in the world for me.
The bad thing about it is with me, I can remember faces pretty good. So the double curse is I know I'm supposed to know them. I know. I mean, I saw somebody last night, and I'm like, I know them. You put yourself in this awkward situation like, hey man, how you doing? Or you use terms just so you until you, then if you're lucky enough, if their name finally pops. How many of y'all like me, and this has happened to me a couple of times, finally in your brain you go, oh, well that's John. And you thought, it's not. So, yeah, we had a high school reunion over here at Friendship, and it was actually two classes, and there was a woman that was there. Anyway, the fellow we went to school with had divorced his first wife and had remarried. I'm not even talking about that. I just thought, well, she aged pretty well. I got to look around at all of us. I said, he's got, she looked, but it wasn't her. Anyway, I called him by the wrong name. And it was okay. It was corrected. You know, well, no, this is my second. So anyway, but by names are yeah, sometimes we don't know, just I was talking about Peter last week about sometimes just feel like he needs to say things. I do that too, just try to fill in the time. It just gets you in trouble. Just sometimes just shut up. Of course then he's like, I turned around, she was gone. Then got over and she said, I told him I saw that on Facebook, he remarried.
At least he didn't hang your shoehorn.
Yeah, you never.
It's still not as bad as a sausage story.
No. Oh, you're talking about the rabbi?
Yeah.
Tried to offer a rabbi sausage in I had to get all of them, we had disaster, I had to get all of them together. And most of them, you know, like Baptist, Presbyterian, whatever, but, you know, I didn't look at the roster. So we got out there on the runway, and the kids from McGavick, they were all laying around with their fake injuries and stuff. And I thought, well, I'll go over and I'll get everybody, it's awesome business. So I come back, they're all standing around there, and I'm passing them out. I come to this guy, and he said, it's hot, it's good. And then he finds, well, I'm Jewish, and I'm and again, didn't know what to say. I said, well, I won't tell anybody. Tom was there that day. And he just laughed. His name, I'll tell you what, his name is Ken Cantor. He may still be a rabbi in Nashville. He's a super nice guy. He's really was nice. You know, he just chuckled. He said, oh. The next year, we had to do a tabletop exercise one year, and then every other year you have to do a full scale. Here's a plane crash, and kids laying around, like, triaging and stuff. Todd was with me then, too. And I'm walking around, you know, trying to be big-eyed Pete or whatever. Anyway, I had used one of the little porta-johns earlier, and I'm walking around, and there's this young lady down on the ground. And she's supposed to have, like, a head injury or whatever. Todd's standing here, and I'm standing. I might have told you this, Tim. She looked up there and said, hey, mister, your pants are open. And I had my shirt tails pulled out of my pants. I've been walking around there. True story, too. Well, long after that, they got a new challenge. Why do we need to get somebody a little more professional?
Your stories make me feel better.
Well, I got, well, remember that I'm coming over here and had the microphone just been in the bathroom over in the old building like a pale mic. Been in there sitting in the bathroom singing. Anyway, names are important. And if you struggle with it, you know, it's okay. And here's something else that's okay too. If you see somebody like Sunday morning or whatever, and you think maybe they've been here, but you're not certain, it's okay to just go up again and say, hey, you know, and to get their name again. If they say, well, you know, I've been here before, okay. They'll get over it. They'll be okay. Most people, though, are all right with that. Well, you know, I've been here a couple of times, or I'm related to such and such, or whatever. That's all right. It's no big deal. But don't let somebody go by you and go out the door, and maybe they haven't been here. We don't want to do that either. It's better just, I've lived my life long enough now, it's just better just be embarrassed every now and then. We get embarrassed over things less than that. So if somebody, or, you know, if they get offended, just say, you know, I'm sorry, I just haven't seen you. I had a woman where we used to worship many, many years ago, that I introduced myself to in the back after service, and she says, wow, I've worshipped here for 20 years. And I said, I haven't seen you. And I haven't. You know, I've not seen you. You've been worshipping here in the balcony or somewhere, because I've not been seeing you, but I didn't see it. But anyway, it's okay. Try to learn people's names if you can. You know, we're trying to build something here at Berea that's special. People, if you know them by the first name, and they'll call my first name, it's special. I mean, every salesman, they people know that. Anyway, so she turned toward him, and this is something else that has always stuck with me. She calls him teacher. There are a lot of other things that she could have called Jesus. You know, Lord and Savior, Master, Creator of the universe. There are lots of things she could have said. Why do you think she chose to call him the teacher?
Because his main goal on earth was teaching.
You're right.
That was his purpose. Teaching.
Well, and remember this too. And of course, things are different now, obviously, the way we treat teachers in our culture. But in their culture, teachers, they were up here. They were special. So it was high praise, actually, when she said that to him. There's a lot of other things she could have called him, but it was high praise for her to just call him that. And keep this in mind too, in Mary's mind, and with all the other disciples and people that Jesus life, he was a teacher. In fact, it's one of the very first things that set him aside from all of the scribes and Pharisees. Remember what the Jews said? He speaks as, he knows what he's talking about. And not only does he teach it, but obviously it's in him. He wasn't just regurgitating the stuff.
The term also referred to the master teacher.
It
wasn't just anybody that happened to be
able
to teach.
Yeah.
This would have been like a master.
You're right. Kevin's exactly right. They had different, well, just, we have the same thing too. Jesus would have been the superior teacher of all. So, it was, before I skip over, I believe we mentioned this from last week. Cindy, when I got home, she'd been studying this verse, this passage, because she knew that's what I was going to teach from. Remember last week, we talked about when they went in the tomb and they found the linens and the little napkin was folded. Talked about how decently in order that was. And y'all may have heard this, but Cindy, she said she'd heard this all her life, that the Jewish customs, especially for men and boys, was if they got up from the table, or anywhere else they might have to be, if they folded their napkin, it meant they were returning for dinner or whatever else. If they just left it wadded up, they were finished. I've never heard that before. So the implication there is, I'm coming back. I folded my napkin. I've never heard it. Have anybody all ever heard that before? I've never heard it. So anyway, didn't mean to skip over that. So I will make sure that you get your props about that wife. And if anybody says that's not true, I'm going to say, well, my wife said it.
I believe it.
I believe it.
I believe it.
I'm going to tell. I'll tell that writing you got to vote. No, it's more than plausible. Evidently, it's factual. So, obviously, he was planning on coming back. So, let's go on to verse 17. Jesus said, "Don't hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God." It's funny how Jesus is so good about including us, who are just like, to me, like lower level life forms, with him. We're all together now. You ever thought about how ridiculously insane it is for us to be joint heirs with Christ? You ever thought about it? It's some, I think about my life and how I've lived and some of the things I've done, and you're gonna make me a joint heir with you. It's out there. I'm telling you, there are a lot of other religions in the world that have deities and stuff. There is no other religion in the world that lets you equate yourself with God. It's big. So, he does it right here. He said, he's going to my God, your God. My Father, your Father. But he also says, and go instead to my brothers. Who do you think he's referring to? James? Physical brother? Who's he talking about? Sure. Turn the page back about where we started this. Back over in chapter 19, get down to John. Jesus' mother standing there. What kind of order did he issue to John about his own mother? About your mother. So, what do we get? You don't have, not just by inference. What do you get here? How did Jesus how do you think Jesus views our fellowship and our family in Christ? How do you think he sees it? Which is tighter? That or
when his family arrived to talk to him one time, the house was really crowded. His family sent word to him, "Hey, your family's outside to talk to you." And he said, "Those that do the will of my Father are my brother."
As you exactly right.
And it's no accident that we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. That we're all family.
It's just, you know, there's a great deal of good from being part of a family, just a biological family. Not all want to minimize that. But I think about all the people, though, that I have known in my life, the members of the Lord's church, the family of God, that I'm way closer to than any of my blood. I'm telling you. And if something went down, we'd call them way quicker than some of my own blood. And that's the way it ought to be. There's nothing wrong with that. Jesus dealt with the same thing. Well, why do you think he told John to take care of his mother? He had other brothers. And why did he tell John to do it?
He was the youngest one, third one.
Yeah.
And he says he's the one that Jesus loved.
Yeah. You know, he
was.
still been having going on. There was a lot of friction. Jesus had to, you know, the one that I love most, we'll talk about another one here later on in the same book, but when James and John and Mama, they come to Jesus, remember what they asked? Remember what she asked?
One on the right.
Yeah, when you come, you know, when you come into your kingdom, I'm gonna two of my boys, I'm gonna eat them. How you think? Well, the Bible, in fact, says how the other disciples react to that. So they had different personalities. They had to get along with each other, but they were still a family. And Jesus makes it pretty important. When he says, my brother's here, he's talking about his disciples. That's who he's talking about.
In fact, on the cross, there's another reason why he didn't say any of his other brothers that were his half-brothers. They weren't there.
That's true. They talked about that 2 or 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, they weren't there.
They weren't there.
And until the resurrection, they didn't believe.
Well, in James, it was long after, before James came around. And again, I give them a little slack because I think about my brother, my sister. You know, even if you're growing up with somebody that obviously was Jesus, and Jesus by his own admission. You know, prophet's not without honor except in his own country, in his own family. In fact, his hometown, they couldn't wrap their mind around him. He's the son of God. It's tough. I mean, think about it. Think about some of the kids you've known that have grown up here. And at 30 years old, well, they start running around saying, well, I'm the son of God. How are you going to react to that? I mean, even if they were the best kid possible, it'd be hard. Yeah, Mike?
Well, to me, that's further proof, though, that the Bible is factual. It would have been easier to talk about, you know, that he was obviously the best kid in the neighborhood, right. All these kind of things. No, he was just a kid. A kid. He was human. He, you know, he wasn't any different. Yeah. You know, so you grow up with your brother. I've got a brother.
Yeah.
And somebody went to him and said, hey, your brother over here is the son of God. He's going to laugh pretty strong,
yeah.
You know. Because he saw me growing up and all the things that happened.
Right.
You know, says Jesus was tempted in every way.
Right.
Well, you know, these other brothers, sisters, you know, we're a pretty sized family.
Yeah.
But they were too familiar.
Correct.
It was more difficult for them. But that helps to me to believe this Bible.
Well, that's me.
Is true. You know.
I can't remember the writer, though, but the quote is, familiarity breeds contempt. It's an old saying. Sad thing about it is it happened in the Lord's church, too.
Yeah.
You'll take people for granted. Familiar with, and you know, whether it's Jesus or another brother or whatever, if you're not real careful, you'll hold them in contempt. It's just, I don't know why people do it.
It happens in families today.
It does.
That's
yeah,
part of why people won't obey the gospel. They remember you as a kid and things you may have said, done, trouble at school, whatever it was, whatever your thing was, and now you're going to tell me how to get there.
Well,
when really it's the Bible telling them how to get there.
I know. I got three guys right now that I'm in school and run around with, and we did some things. One of them was a doctor, one of them was a dentist, and I always in the back of my mind, I'm like, I don't think I'm going to go with him. Well, he's a grown man now. Well-followed, they're right here in this community. I'm not going to name their names, but and I'm still very close to them, but in the back of my mind, I'm like, Yeah.
I was going to say, the only insight we have into the life of Jesus when he was being raised as a boy was when they went to the temple when he was 12, and they left, and they went a day's journey before they realized he wasn't with them, which meant they had to do another day to get back. And then when they got back, they searched 3 days for him. So he was missing 5 days. And where did they find him? In the temple. Now, if you and I went to go find Jesus in Jerusalem, we'd have gone to the temple. But I believe he was like any other little boy
other
day. And they had no idea where.
right, we know, looking back, you know, but they didn't have the benefit of that, so they might have went to just different places where kids would go, I don't know. You're right. Yeah, so again, I give them a little bit of latitude there, as far as the ones that were close to them, it's just hard for them to accept that Jesus Christ, this boy that grew up in Mary and Joseph's house, he's the son of God. That's tough. Even in spite of all the things that he did. So the brothers here, without a doubt, his spiritual brothers, his Christian brothers. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things. So the first thing she does is she goes to the disciples, which actually answers the question that I just asked. She didn't run to his physical, biological brothers. She ran to the disciples. So she knew exactly what he meant. So he goes and says, I've seen the Lord, and he has told me, and he's told me all these things. Let me go just a little bit further. Yeah, I'm going to go a little bit further, then we'll quit. I think last week I just kind of cut off in the middle. I'm trying to find a good place to stop. It's a good story. This story is just a good story. I don't want to leave anything out. On the evening of the first day, once again, don't sound stupid, first day of the week, what day was this?
Sunday.
It was Sunday night. First day when the disciples were together with the doors locked, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Let me read a little bit further, I'm going to stop. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they're not forgiven. We talk a lot and we place a lot of emphasis, and rightfully so, on the day of Pentecost and the miraculous gifts of the Holy Spirit, or baptism of the Holy Spirit. When's the first time Jesus was the Bible referred to as God breathing on these? It's right here. Let me ask you something else too. In this particular company of people, and I won't debate it too long tonight, but we may debate it next week. All these people that are meeting there, men and women?
Mm-hmm. Well, sure.
Sure there was. I don't know whose house particularly, but no. When Jesus did this, he breathed on men and women? It doesn't differentiate, it says everybody. So it's important, regardless of how later on the church designates the roles of men and women, at this particular time it's pretty important to realize that there was no distinction made here. Women can preach and teach the gospel in their own ways, just like men can. Sometimes we get caught up in that in the church, and sometime we'll get into Acts, we'll talk about there are things that men are supposed to do and authorized to do in the church that women aren't. I'm not saying that, but I am saying this. But as far as Jesus is concerned, as far as the effectiveness of the preaching of the gospel is concerned, he didn't differentiate. I think about Aquila and Priscilla, some of the other women in the Bible that brought people to God. We'll talk about that some more, though, when we get into Acts one day. Then I'm going to say this and we'll quit. What are you going to do? You see your best friend or your buddy or a teacher or maybe even somebody that you really, really think a lot of. You've seen a murder. You know they've been buried for 3 days. And now you've got your door locked in the house. You turn around and they're standing next to your kitchen table.
Well, I wonder about that. Said they were overjoyed. That's not the reaction I would have.
No, that's not the reaction I would have. I would have probably passed out. They were overjoyed. And here's what gets me in connection with overjoyed. They were overjoyed because he showed them the wounds that he had. These wounds, listen, y'all, were gruesome. They were gruesome wounds. But there again, though, in order for them to believe that this is, you know, wasn't a trick and you didn't imagine it, this is the same body that you saw hanging up there, or looks like. Keep this in mind, too. And I will leave this to my esteemed colleague Kevin to debate. What kind of body did Jesus have at this time?
Changed. What did it say? The doors were locked. Why?
physical injury.
They thought they might come anytime, take them and do the same thing.
Right.
So the door was locked and yet he's.
Got in there.
So that's a different body.
You know.
And yet, we'll see that he sits down and eats and, you know.
I think in the religious world and even Christianity in general, we have this idea that this spiritual body we're gonna be given, I think maybe the world maybe has crept in, is gonna be some kind of, I don't know how to describe it, like a floaty, spirity ghost thing. That's, you know, not something that, you know, is tangible, not something that's, that, and that's just not, the Bible doesn't teach that. The Bible doesn't teach that. This body that it has here, it changed. Now, did it resemble physical form of the one that hung? Yeah, because here's the one, here's my side. I have literally been resurrected, Spirit of God. And so they can see this. It wasn't a ghost, and you're right. Mike can sit down and eat breakfast with him.
Like, they can touch.
You can touch him. We'll worry about Thomas next week. He actually, Thomas is still like, Thomas, I would have been like Thomas. We'll talk about him some next week. Ain't no way. But he figures out a way. Yes, there is a way. So it's just the whole concept. And again, there are a lot of different ideas in there, out there in the world about religion and resurrection and afterlife. Christian story and this resurrection story, it's very, very different from anything that you'll find out there floating around. It's different. And I don't claim to understand all the things that are involved in resurrection or reanimating a body that's dead and transforming it into a spiritual body that resembles, I don't know. Jesus is, and we'll talk about some more, there's some other gospel accounts about his being able, after the fact, to, he could actually do it before the fact too, but be able to make himself invisible. Crazy stuff, but, or maybe make himself look like somebody else. You were married, didn't even recognize. She said, you know, are you the gardener or something? Where's my... But it was him. So it's just a plane of existence. It's just hard for us to comprehend and understand. I just take comfort in the fact of knowing that we can share that same kind of body that will live forever. We'll quit. We'll pick up there next week. If you would, I'm going to have an invitation here.
421.
Part of my daily Bible studies, I've been in Psalms, revisiting some of the ones that I have highlighted and marked. If you're like me, especially this year in particular, I have increased my Bible reading intentionally. In Psalms, I mean, come on, if you're looking for a go-to book, and you feel like things maybe aren't going your way, if you can't go to Psalms, where are you going to go? Because some of the stuff that David talks about there is just classic. But there's one I want to share with you. Psalms 130, verse 3. Psalmist says, if you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore, you are feared. You know, most of my life, I always equated forgiveness with love. And we should. We know that for us to get forgiveness of sin, Jesus, his love, came here, God sent him here, and that's true. But the psalmist says something here that we don't need to forget either. He says, because of your forgiveness, you are feared, you're respected. And a lot of times in Christianity today, and I use that in the generic sense, there's an overemphasis placed on, well, God loves me so much that I can do whatever and I can never. The Bible doesn't teach that. The psalmist says here, your forgiveness, because you forgive people, I need to respect you. I need to fear you. I think about sometimes how far the church has drifted as far as our reverence, even in our worship services, not much less our daily lives, but even in our worship service. Have you ever felt like before you have you ever worshiped and thought maybe that there just wasn't enough respect or reverence during the worship service? I've been in places before, and I felt uneasy about it. There has to be, because God forgives our sins, there has to be a healthy reverence and respect for Him But the same relationship exists between us and God. He loves us. It's a fact. But in order to gain that forgiveness, and he's the one that has to do it, there has to be some kind of respect or fear. I don't know what your needs are tonight. I know we mentioned a lot of folks earlier that have and really need our prayers. Don't forget them tonight and this week in your private prayer life. But if there's something publicly you want to come forward about, we're here. Now's a great time to do it. We can do it for you. We can pray for you. That's one of the benefits of being part of God's family. So if you need to respond, do so now to send us our song.
I sing in deep content, out of the peaceful shore, very deep the same within, sing to Christ the Lord. But the master of the sea heard my staring cry, from the waters lifted me, now saved am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look and love, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, billows his will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Be seated. Before we dismiss, we'll sing 137. Mike, would you lead us in that closing prayer? Any announcements, any other announcements need to be made? 137. We'll sing the first and last verse.
There is Lord Jesus, ruler of
struggling at this point in time with all that we have faced this year. And Father, we confess that we are burdened by doubt and sometimes fear and anxiety, and we know, Father, that none of that comes from you. And we just pray, Lord, that you will strengthen us in our faith, that you will lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one, that you lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Lord, we praise you as the one and only true and living God. We're so thankful for Jesus, for his life, for his death, especially his resurrection. We're thankful that he sits at your right hand and intercedes on our behalf. And we pray that every name on our sick list, Lord Jesus, that you take them before the Father. You know each one. You know their very special needs. And we just pray that you be merciful. We pray that you bless them with your healing hand, that you guide their doctors and nurses in the decisions that they make. We pray for healing, Lord. And we pray for faith to accept your response, whatever it may be, because we recognize you answer every prayer, whether we receive healing in this world or in the world to come. And Father, we just trust in you. We know we can't trust in the seen, it's temporary, and we pray that you'll bless us to trust more and more in the unseen, for it's everlasting. Bless us.